Yes, we are live.
Good evening to you all. I welcome you on behalf of Ananchuri to today's Thursday session on gender and sexuality. I am Kiran Keshav Murthy and I teach English at IIT Guwahati. And today, I'll be speaking on behalf of Ananchuri, a non-profit collective platform that creates networks between researchers, thinkers, academics, activists, and so on. Since Thursday session is on broadly on gender and sexuality, we have a speaker today whose work specializes in that, Navanita Mokkil. Let me just begin by introducing you to the speaker. Just a second. So Navanita Mokkil teaches at the Center for Women's Studies, Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. Her research and teaching focus on cultural practices and the non-linear imaginations of sexuality in India. She's the author of Unruly Figures, Queerness, Sex Work, and the Politics of Sexuality in Kerala, 2019, and the co-editor of Thinking Women, a Feminist Reader, which also came out in 2019. So it gives me great pleasure to welcome today's speaker, Navanita Mokkil. Thank you, and we look forward to listening to you.
Thanks, Tim, for the introduction, and to the Ananchuri team for inviting me and giving me this space. So I actually have because the time is sort of limited, I have a written, paper, because I thought that would be easier, especially with the online mode. So I could read it, and then, I hope you can open it up and have a conversation, right? Because otherwise I find it very difficult to keep to time. So, I also have a PowerPoint, so I'll, pull that up.
Okay.
You can see it, right?
Yes.
Okay. Let me start this with this Malayalam film, which came out in 2018. And the film is titled Iratta Jeevitham in Malayalam, which translates as The Dual Life. And the English title they used was The Dual, which is a film by Suresh Narayan. And if you look at the opening of the film, it shows a crowded street in Kerala. The slow-moving camera captures different aspects of the street, political posters, speeding buses, party flags, and advertisements for jobs, credit cards, silk saris, and gold jewelry. Then we see the central protagonist of the film, a trans man, Adraman, walk past and look up at the large-sized poster of the film pasted on the wall. He looks with attention at the sepia-tinted image of the seashore with the title of the film, Iratta Jeevitham, painted on it. In the spatial composition of this frame, the poster stretches out in a panoramic fashion, and Adraman becomes a small figure enveloped by the visual landscape. This sequence from a recent film that lays open the fraught negotiations of gender and sexuality in a coastal town in Kerala allows me to introduce to all of you the constitutive relations between cultural practices, regionality, and the formations of queerness. In this presentation, I aim to explore how the animated circuits of vernacular cultural practices allow us to trace the shifting contours of queer politics in India today. In my analysis of the Malayalam film, Desharna Kili Karyadla, The Migratory Bird Does Not Cry, from 1986, one of the anchoring texts of my book, Unruly Figures, Queerness, Sex Work, and the Politics of Sexuality in Kerala, And actually, the good news is that the Indian edition of the book just came out like 2 days ago. So the second cover is, from Zuban. That's the Indian edition. So I'm happy that it's available. So if you look at the image on the left side, the image is of the book cover, actually from the film Decharna Keli Karyagila, which is one of the central texts, that I analyze in the book. Which is an early film that looks at the relationship between two young women and their movements, they are sort of wandering movements as they run away from school together and sort of inhabit the space of Kochi in Kerala. And their wanderings do not necessarily reach a destination, but it activates spaces they traverse. And that, I argue, is key to the possibilities of queerness that we can locate in the film. Practices of inhabiting bodies and spaces in ways that render the home unfamiliar are significant to trace the disruptive potential of queer encounters in different regional contexts. Through my use of the term vernacular frames in the title of the presentation, I gesture towards cultural forms that stitch together the everyday imaginations of different linguistic contexts in India, ranging from popular B-grade cinema to autobiographical writings or sensational fiction. And this might differ in different regional contexts, but I think there is an argument to be made about how these modes of analysis are important for different regions in India. I point to how contemporary representations of queerness hinges on the citation and reiteration of these vernacular forms that are recast in order to body forth non-normative narratives of sexuality and gender. In Anguli figures, I track the cultural practices through which sexual figures are produced in the public imagination and how these figures are accessed and deployed by marginalized sexual subjects, primarily the sex worker and the lesbian, as they stage their own journeys of resistance in the post-1990s context. I argue that such intertextual cultural traffic is the basis of a vernacular politics of sexuality. Thus, my analysis foregrounds how regional spaces can function as sites of unfinished stories of resistance. The vernacular idioms of sexuality politics in India draws attention to material concerns such as access to public spaces, employment and housing, the shifting conceptions of the family, caregiving and collectives, and also asks us to focus on the unrelenting violence against bodies that are marked as excessive, even within the rights-bearing model of LGBT politics. It pushes for a vision of queer politics marked by irresolution and fragility. As we are brought face to face with the vulnerability of dispossessed sexual subjects, on the one hand, we are sort of made aware of the vulnerability of sexual subjects, but we also become aware of the movements in these spaces that have the potential to realign how we think about sexuality politics and therefore put forward a different set of articulations about the challenges of building relational networks in the face of continuing erasure and violence. These risky transactions by marginalized sexual subjects in non-metropolitan spaces shows us that we should not read constraints as an absence of movement. In different regional contexts in India, we need to think more carefully about how queerness is shaped by the structures of access and mobility closely linked to stratifications of class, community, and caste. These larger concerns form the basis of my presentation today, in which I introduce some of the key ideas of the book project, Unruly Figures. But I also, towards the end of the talk, will explore some of the new directions of some new work that I'm doing around, especially cinema and sexuality. So moving on to a short introduction to some of the key ideas of of Unruly Figures. My interventions in Unruly Figures participate in emerging scholarly and activist attempts to reorient the debates on sexuality in India by taking into account fraught trajectories of the political that trouble the framework of identity and rights. moving away from an emphasis on law and policy making as the site for social transformation, I navigate the pulsating links between subjective negotiations and cultural practices. As the title itself suggests, the book traces the practices through which the sex worker and the lesbian take shape in the public sphere using visual and verbal mediums. I ask, how does the lesbian or sex worker become recognizable figures in the public imagination of Kerala? What are the modalities through which these figures emerge as autobiographical subjects, fictional protagonists, targets of governance, sites of injury, or political icons? What are the excesses triggered by these figurations? Instead of solely relying on forms such as the novel, life narrative, or poetry that have been associated with the fashioning of modern subjects, my analysis insists that subjectivity is staged in and through modes, forms, and styles that span a range of interlinked domains, such as the state and the media, the publishing industry, and art practices. Thus, the relation between interiority and exteriority, private and public, and the subject and figure are constantly explored and realigned in my analysis. The different genres that I look at in this book, such as popular cinema, news photography, novels, and autobiographies, are sites where the marginalized subject lays claim to recognition, but they are also simultaneously the surfaces through which sexual figures are exposed to public view. The post-90s is marked by the emergence of the sex worker and the lesbian as political actors in Kerala society through collective mobilizations. This has produced texts and events that embody the experiments of self-fashioning by sexually marginalized actors. In these sites of cultural production, such as the dual autobiographical project by Nalini Jamila, the first book is titled Uru Laingika Urlariyude Atmakatha, The Autobiography of a Sex Worker. And in a span of 6 months, she produced a second version of her autobiography, which is the second book cover, which was called Me Sex Worker, Nalini Jamila's autobiography. And both the books were collaborations with different people. The sex workers enters into representation here by critiquing the recognizable tropes through which a prostitute is addressed and configured by the state and non-governmental institutions. So in some ways, what I'm looking at is how it's not so much that Jamila is telling a new story, but that the power of her project is that it can sort of interrupt and expose the limits of paradigms of voicing and visibility and the modalities through which the sex worker is often put into circulation in the public sphere. The very transaction through which a marginalized subject claims the status of I is a negotiation with the grammar of the social she inhabits. This is an exposure of the self in ways that can be rendered legible to the other, whether it is the public or in some instances, the witness within the narrative. While self-narratives are often read as an expression of interiority, recent scholarship on first-person narratives in India dislodges this link. I problematize the conception of an occluded sexual subject that the researcher has to discover or uncover, especially when dealing with marginalized actors from contexts like regional contexts in India. Instead, I analyze the transactions through which the subject negotiates his or her relation to structures of visibility and legibility. There's a long array of autobiographies told to narratives and testimonials by marginalized actors published in Malayalam since the late 1990s. Yet the first person voice and direct address spills over to many other forms, whether they are interviews, oral narratives, reality TV shows, documentary films, or public service advertisements produced by the state, the media, and multinational public agencies. The formal transactions in these texts and their modes of circulation and address become the ground through which I dismantle the binaries of passivity and activity, victim and empowerment. The relationship between the subject and the figure is a negotiated one that is always in process. The figure can be seen as a representation that acquires iconic value in a public sphere. For example, the domestic woman is an idealized figure in the public imaginary of Kerala. And this foundational figure is constructed through repeated tropes in cultural productions, whether a cinema or advertising or even state-produced materials. I analyze public events and cultural circuits that provides a visualization of the process of sedimentation through which such emblematic figures are made. By using the term figure and figuration, I also underline the links between language and imagery, the visual and the verbal, as connected practices in the making of the public sphere of Kerala. The concept of figures of speech, though linguistic in its origin, holds within it practices of perception, since the idea of the figure is also visual. These figures are recognizable because of their reiteration in the public sphere. But the reason these figures lend themselves to analysis is because they are never completely solidified and are always in the process and open to contestation. The process of figuring through cultural practices retains a level of instability that disturbs unilateral conceptions of masculinity and femininity. The importance of the concept of the figure and why it lends itself to my investigation is linked to its formulation through public practices and especially cultural practices. The ceaseless movements between the subject and figure, what Uday Kumar calls in writes as the imperfect inhabitation of narrativizable identities. That's a quote from Uday Kumar's book, are what I term as unruly figurations. In order to trace these movements, I develop a theoretical vocabulary consisting of terms that emerge from the sites that I analyze, such as stutter, blur, and Malayalam terms like arinyattam, loose dance would be what it translates as, and deshadanam, which is migration and wandering. These theoretical concepts that are drawn from the regional sites also function as vernacular frames. Thus, there is a risky task of cultural translation I undertake as a scholar in this book. I make available for a larger academic analysis the cultural world of Kerala. In writing about an all too familiar and familial world, but approaching it through the critical lens of academic discourse, I struggle to point to the limits of translation, to reflect on what is gained by foregrounding incommensurability. Encountering a research project that presents a different context can be intellectually productive when the field of investigation has the power to point to the limits of one's tools of analysis. But the challenge of my return journey to Kerala was how conscious I became of my own knowledge formations and how they are rendered insufficient by what I initially assumed was a familiar world. So in some ways, I'm also trying to think about what does it mean to conduct research projects that are based on spaces that is, that is a familiar one and ones that you are embedded in particular ways, and how through the process of research it allows you to undo some of your frames of looking. These moments of vulnerability, when the dominant paradigms of the public, of agency, of rights and of resistance are reconfigured by regional discourses, are productive tensions in my work. Now I'll move on to think a little bit about, currently, how do I place my work and where do I take it, in this present moment. Unruly Figures was conceptualized, researched and written over a period of about 10 years. There was a gap between finishing the dissertation, revising it, and then finally bringing it out as a book. The primary research for this book was done in 2007 to 2010, when the Global AIDS Prevention and Awareness Missionary played a crucial role in making categories such as the commercial sex worker and men who have sex with men, MSM, CSW, this kind of new vocabulary of sexual actors as targets of governance, right? As you are all aware, sexuality, politics, and formations of queerness in India has undergone considerable shifts in the last two decades, both in terms of legal and cultural representations. While the struggle for reading down of Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code is often perceived as an overarching framework for this period, my research demonstrates that the rights-bearing sexual subject cannot be the fulcrum to anchor the long ruptured history of the politics of sexuality in different parts of India. So we often see how the Supreme Court judgment in the Navneet Singh Johar versus Union of India in September 2018 is hailed as, you know, for example, international media welcomed it with headlines like India backs freedom, others should follow. This is from Guardian. Or India's riotous triumph of equality. This is New York Times, September 7, 2018. In the light of these kind of celebratory proclamations, my exploration functions as a timely reminder about the dangers of creating such a teleology of sexual progress with set moments of origin and arrival, right? We should remember that the judgment comes at a time when India has witnessed systemic violence against religious minorities and Dalits, massive unemployment and dismantling of social welfare structures, and increasing surveillance and throttling of forms of dissent. The passing of the Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Act in December 2019 further brings to the fore how state legislation can violently erase political articulations by trans persons. Thus, we need to take into account the starkly differential positioning of privileged and dispossessed sexual subjects in the current juncture. In the last chapter of Unruly Figures, I draw on the memorialization of the murder of transgender activist Sweet Maria to explore how sexuality politics in Kerala continued to be imbued with a racking sense of irresolution. The brutal murder of Sweet Maria on May 10, 2012, under circumstances that continue to be unclear, shocked activists and supporters of sexuality movements in different parts of India. Noted activist A.K. Jayashree, in her obituary for Sweet Maria, says that Maria's murder showed yet again how, and I quote, how torturous it is to lead a different kind of life in Kerala, unquote. The recent reports of the suicides of young women in lesbian relationships in Kerala, including the death of two college students in Kottayam on November 16th, that was reported very recently in November 16th, 2020, Anjana Harish's suicide in March 2020, and all the reports and speech that emerged around familial and psychiatric institutions and how that led to the death, right? And also the multiple reports of life-threatening violence against transgender persons in different parts of India, such as the recent murder of a transgender activist in Coimbatore in October 2020. So when you look at all these kind of reportage from different contexts in India about continuing violence, it also allows us to think about how the precariousness of acts of living remains the undercurrent of sexuality politics in multiple contexts in India today. Sweet Maria Monument, Doing and Undoing an Imaginary Archive, an art exhibition by Arya Krishnan in Ambedkar University, Delhi in May 2014, was envisaged as a multimedia monument for Maria and curated the work of multiple artists who engaged with concerns about body and sexuality. In 2019, another version of this exhibition was on display at the Kochi Museums Biennale. This exhibition is a tribute to Maria's life by collecting and displaying objects and images linked to her life, such as clothes, artifacts, video footage, and photos, and also by building communities around this interactive space. Arya Krishnan observes in the 2014 catalog that there is no given language at any point of time for politics and aesthetics. Therefore, the process of monumentalizing Maria is a fragmented exercise that is bound to fail. Arya Krishna is well aware that the archive he assembles in this exhibition undercuts the documentary impulse of state and humanitarian projects because it does not commit itself to the project of knowledge production in which the subject is measured, mapped, and rendered legible. Monumentalizing and archiving could be read as practices that give solidity and permanence to the past and produce a record that can classify bodies, events, or act. But rather than order, solidity, and stasis, here in the exhibition, the emphasis is on movement and change. Not only is the archive imaginary, it is also tied to a perpetual circle of doing and undoing, in which the various traces of Maria's body are gathered and dispersed in the space of the exhibition. The exhibition catalog and a short film that was part of the exhibition works through the irresolvable tensions of doing queer politics in India today. Arinyatam, Loose Dance, was a short film that consists primarily of footage from the first Queer Pride March in Kerala, organized in Thrissur in 2010. And this short film ran on a loop in the interactive arts space. The short film consists of shots of organizers preparing for the first Queer Pride March in Kerala, 1 year after the Delhi High Court judgment that was then hailed as effectively decriminalizing homosexuality. And we see a gathering of people who collect and linger to see this site on the streets of Thrissur. The recording is not event driven. The camera meanders and does not hierarchize between the consequential and the inconsequential. The camera is often handheld and marked by sudden jerks, blurred images, and quick pans. It shows us trees, shop fronts, the grass, the grounds, the stones on the ground, the gathering of activists and supporters, putting up the banner, distributing masks, tying up the rainbow flag, and the actions of onlookers around them. The sound recording is muffled and is not in sync. We hear traffic sounds and snatches of conversation. The dominant perception of queer pride marches is in terms of breaking the silence, asserting identity, coming out and embracing visibility. In fact, the banner of this march says from silence to celebrations. There are other documentary films whose aesthetic practices uphold this framework of visibility as agency. In contrast to this, Arinyatam injects a seething sense of uncertainty into the framework of visibility and identity that is central to the conception of the Queer Pride March itself. It captures how Queer Pride marches in Kerala consisted of a coalition of diverse sets of people and their tentative attempts to forge new practices to claim the public. This points to how even a paradigmatic event in the global LGBT movement, such as the Queer Pride March, does not travel seamlessly to all parts of the world. There are multiple fissures in its enactment in different contexts. The contradictions of strategies of visibility in volatile and mediated publics are made available for analysis in the memorialization of Maria. There is much concern about how Maria's claiming of public space through her bodily practices, clothing, and opinions expressed in TV talk shows might have played a role in her murder. Photographs of her dressed up for a queer pride parade in flowing gowns of pulsating colors and glimmering fabric accompany almost all the obituaries written after Maria's death. She stands out prominently in the recorded images of queer pride marches in 2010 and 2012. An eye-catching profusion of red fabric, a voluminous skirt that dangled like a ballooning tent from the ceiling to the ground in the exhibition space by Arya Krishnan, pays tribute to this desire on Maria's part to invent a corporeal language for politics that flagrantly pushes against the visual regimes of gendered bodies and sartoriality in Kerala. I quote here from Arya Krishnan's catalog, and this is a quote. It says, there's a difference in raising a question in an existing political humanitarian language and stitching your own costumes, which doesn't represent Kerala or queer or anything in particular. It is a making. You are inventing something which doesn't represent any essential content to it. So when somebody is enacting that kind of a politics, what is happening? End quote. Like the swirling movements of fabric in vibrant red of Maria's gown that takes the center stage in the exhibition space, we enter here into the realm of figurations that are not the means to an end. Rather, the uncontained movements itself have an expressive power, an intense yet fleeting potential to disrupt the edifices of the present. The narrative about her life and death reflect on the disjointed gestures of a subject who put her body on the line and did not follow existing scripts. In the quote from Arya Krishnan, reproduced above, terms such as stitching, making, and inventing capture the expressive potential of everyday political acts that do not reproduce pre-given templates. In the oral narratives on lesbian suicides and the autobiographical practices by sex worker and activist Nalini Jamila that I focus on in my book, questions are raised about how the contours of the political are destabilized when marginalized bodies that do not fit into the mold of the political subject makes claims for justice. The same question reverberates in a different fashion in the remembering of Sweet Maria's life and politics. Arinyattam, the title of the short film, literally refers to a loose dance, unchoreographed movements like that of a thread that is left free, unspooled, directionless. The term artam means both dance and movement. It can be used to refer to movements of the body and also ways of inhabiting space. The term arinyattam is gendered and sexual in its connotations. It's often used negatively to refer to the actions of women who do not discipline themselves to stay within the limits of ideal femininity. A disorderly femininity is marked by the sensual exhibition of the body and unruly movements in space. Arya Krishnan writes about how Maria used her body to challenge and rewrite dominant conceptions of masculinity and femininity. She accessed and provocatively deployed the prototype of the loose woman who is available for a sexualized gaze. Thus, Arinyattam consciously invokes practices of viewing sexually explicit films and remembers the figurations of women performers, such as the spectacle of women's bodies in low-budget Malayalam films. It underlines the fissures in the fabric of the social in Kerala, where film viewing practices and low-budget theatres function as a site of sexual excess. There are multiple ways in which cultural practices, especially from the world of cinema, are brought into the space of the exhibition. A drawing of a dressed-up Maria with an A, adults only, written on her pink skirt is the image that accompanies the catalogue. The image was also placed like a film poster in the entrance of the exhibition space. The title Arinyattam is written in big block red letters on a splash of yellow, reminiscent of the title cards of low-budget soft porn cinema. By bringing in the aesthetic codes and modes of circulation of soft porn cinema into the space of the art exhibition, there's an attempt to keep alive the multiple layers through which sexuality politics is performed in regional contexts. It's important to note here that the mood of Arinyattam is not celebratory. It is cut by a deep sense of loss and uncertainty. It is as if the recorded footage of the march insists on the ephemerality of queer acts as an undeniable reality that demands reckoning in sexuality politics in India. As the footage is edited for its exhibition screening, there are certain insertions that accentuate this sense of loss and looking backwards. Taking footage of the Pride March and intercutting it with short interludes produces a text that is haunted by absent yet present voices and bodies. The film's title card says Arinyattam in and as directed by Maria, granting authorship to Maria even as she was absent in the assembling of the film after her death. Thus, Arinyattam is haunted by Maria's presence. One sequence that is repeated twice, both times in slow motion, is Maria's flamboyant entry into the 2010 Queer Pride in her satin rainbow-colored gown that unfurls around her. This theatrical entry is intercut with a grainy recording of Maria performing a popular Malayalam song from the 1970s, noted for its expression of sensual feminine desire and erotic rendering of the woman's body. The gendered markers of Maria's body are different in both the clips. The gown and earrings, which are part of her gendered performance in the first clip, is absent in the second one. Dressed in a blue checkered shirt and loose black pants, Maria lip syncs and performs the sensual moves of an iconic Malayalam heroine in the latter clip. There are indications of an audience who watches this performance and claps in the end. Then for a second, the screen goes pitch black while the recording song continues to play on and unanchored by the image. After this gaping blackness, the film cuts back to the scene of the Pride March. There are discordant layers of time and space and differential expressions of gender and sexuality splice into this footage. The celebrations of the queer Pride marches are pervaded by the reverberating voice, the painful memory of a life rendered unlivable within given social structures. Through replaying these performative renderings of desire in the interactive space of the art exhibition, questions about doing queer politics suffuses the march as we look at it retrospectively. The traces of lives and bodies that met with brutal ends bleed into the footage of the queer Pride March and raise pertinent questions about the structures of violence in the present and how to imagine possibilities for the future. Thus, we can see how the vernacular idioms of sexuality politics places scenographies of death, violence, desire, and protest as intertwined with each other. Arya Krishnan, in an interview, mentioned that in the Kochi Biennale, he built the art exhibition, Sweet Maria Monument, as a living space and wanted to create communities and practices around the movement. A quote from Aryan's interview says, "Each time this monument is being made by the interaction and events which takes place around the monument. Chinju Ashwati, an intersex activist from Kerala, was invited as a speaker in a panel discussion at the monument called Disidentifications, Conversations on Everyday Caste and Queerness. Chinju couldn't make it as they were attacked while accessing a public toilet and had to be hospitalized. This is an example of the everyday violence LGBTQI communities face. Maria's story is not an isolated one. Since the monument is not a permanent structure, it can accommodate change. This way, new stories, solidarities, and communities of sense emerge out of it," unquote. The search for space and self-expression by marginalized sexual subjects in hostile settings and under extreme constraints set into motion an idiom of negotiations that draws on and redeploys available tools. It is through the reenactments and transpositions of cultural texts and idioms that sexual norms are disturbed. This cross-fertilization between the popular and the political, the unruly circuits through which cultural texts circulate, come alive, and become imbued with multiple meanings is crucial for a vernacular politics of sexuality. Do we have some more time, Kiran? How am I doing with time? Yeah. Shall I end with that short section on new cinema practices? It won't take much. So I'll move on from here to give you to speak a bit about some new work that I'm doing in, connected to sexuality and cinema. So a recent set of films set in non-metropolitan spaces in India, which I am currently working on, such as Swarnaveer Ishwaran's Kattamaran, Reema Das's Bulbul Can Sing, and Suresh Narayan's Irakta Jeevanam, opens up powerful modes of representing queerness embedded in vernacular economies of bodies and desires, even as these films travel in transnational circuits. And for now, I'll just focus on Irakta Jeevanam. Irakta Jeevanam tells the story of Adraman, who returns to a coastal village after he disappeared from his home some years ago when he was known as Amina. His beloved companion Saina is now a married woman, and we bear witness to the tensions and seething love between them. Quote again, we can't behave like before. We have been split into two as man and woman, is an anguished statement that Saina tells Adraman. My desire was not something that could be revealed openly then, says Adraman in return. One of the evocative scenes in Irakta Jeevanam is towards the end of the film, after Adraman tells Saina that he would have put up with all the difficulties in his life if she were with him. In this conversation, they're both seated on the seashore, and we see them separated in single counter frames. Saina does not verbally respond to Adraman, but the film cuts to a sequence of Adraman on the top of a jamun tree, shaking the tree, and the soft pulpy fruit falls on Saina, who gathers the fruit. The sound of the sea merges with the sound of music. We hear the soft thud of jamuns falling on her. The luscious purple juice smatter her face and smear her hands. And we see Adraman eat the luscious fruit as he passionately looks down at Saina, and she looks up at him with a smile. This is both a remembered scene, but also a fantasy sequence, because here Saina is her younger self, but Amina has transitioned to Adraman. The play of colors, sounds, and tactile sensations imbues the scene with a heady erotic charge, and the sequence then cuts to the shot of the older Saina sitting alone with a smear of purple juice on her face. She touches her face and licks her fingers. The love between Adraman and Saina goes against the societal norms, and there are verbal prohibitions against it by community members. But their relationship acquires a visual and tactile form by drawing on the conventions of representing sexual intimacy and romance in Malayalam cinema. The capacity of cinema to activate sensory registers and choreograph romance is operationalized in these films. This fantasy sequence in Iratta Jeevitham, the long takes of their walk together in a beach with casuarina trees, in many ways the film draws on and reinvents the spatial and bodily idioms that are often used to materialize desire in Indian cinema in order to stage queer desire. These unruly trajectories of cinema desire and embodied modes of reception offers differing entry points to trace vernacular imaginations of queerness that disrupts the paradigms of rights, visibility, and recognition. The linkages between desiring cinema and the desire for different modes of being keeps alive the potential of queerness as a horizon that foregrounds the link between cultural practices, public imaginations, and sexuality politics. Thus, these sensual circuits of cinema offer a productive site to trace unruly trajectories of the public formations of sexuality. I seek to show how the potential for transformation is kept alive in non-metropolitan spaces by drawing on the unruly movements generated in the cultural and material domains in which sexual actors are enmeshed. This positioning of marginalized subjects, their fraught and yet generative relation to their immediate surroundings, has to be taken into account as we search for an elsewhere. My research captures the need to revise politics in favor not of a set path, but of one that holds within it different possibilities. We have to tactically reinvent categories of analysis and ways of reading so that we can engage with the unstable horizons of the political. Thus, I hope that multiple possibilities for future conversations can be opened up through an engagement with vernacular imaginations of sexuality politics. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Navanita, for that very articulate presentation. Thank you very much. I just have a few observations. Maybe I will just start by asking you a few questions or making a few comments, and then we can shift to the audience. The audience is welcome to post their questions on the chat box or unmute yourself one after the other and ask the speaker questions. So please, while I have my discussion with the speaker, then please do think of your questions and put them up in the chat box. Navanita, so I it was a very interesting presentation, which kind of made me think a lot about different visual media. I mean, you were talking about Maria's exhibition. You were also talking of which kind of also includes photography and film. You were also talking about your own work with activists, with sex workers who are activists, also with lesbians who may be activists. your own live interactions with them. And you kind of also came up with this term vernacular idiom, the vernacular politics. So I was just, I was also kind of, maybe you have addressed this in other parts of your book, but also thinking about, the suicide letter. The suicide letter and the kind of the how some of the early kind of not early but the most early reported lesbian suicides in Kerala became very well known. I mean, and it's kind of it'll be interesting to see why those particular cases drew so much of attention, public media attention, and what was the so I was also thinking in terms of the performance also in terms of not just the visual medium, but also maybe in terms of writing. I mean, I know that you may have somewhere touched upon literary works as well as non-fictional works in Nalini Jamila and others, in terms of the essay, in terms of the novel, in terms of the testimony, but also in terms of, the suicide letter, the kind of the performance of that form. I'm sure there's a certain performative act. When people write letters, it's not just like any other letter. Like, we have seen Vemula's letter also. I mean, there's a certain performance to it. And I think there's something very powerful, something very evocative about these letters. When if you read them as a specific genre of writing, you would also see that it has certain formal distinctions, are making gestures towards self-assertion, you must remember, for example, the visual images of the lesbian suicide of the women holding hands in a haystack or on a truck, I think. I'm not sure if it was on a haystack or somewhere, but they were holding hands and the attention, the gaze was fixed on the holding of the hands, the interlinking of the fingers and the letter that they left behind. And the letter, of course, is also not just about, it's rarely only about their own lives or about, their sexuality. It's about how their lives and their perspectives of the world are linked to larger questions of, social structures of family, of religion, of class and caste, of poverty, economic inequalities, and so on. So I was just wondering if you could, maybe address this question of, this vernacular idiom, whether you think there's something specific to Kerala, which makes it rather different from, let's say, the neighboring South Indian states, or maybe even some of the other states in India. What is the specific intervention that you think the social and public sphere of Kerala has made in terms of interrupting national, liberal, national democratic scripts, of gender and sexuality? And in what way do you think they have reformulated, reconfigured these scripts, brought about new configurations and so on?
Yeah, thanks, Kiran. That's a lot of things to think through. In terms of, the usage of the question of idioms, right? Like, and the question of the the literary in some ways is not so in this presentation, for the limits of time I couldn't really talk about it, but I think in some ways I think like one of the significant ways in which Kerala's public sphere gets configured is also because of this constant interaction between the visual and the verbal forms, right? Like, so in some ways, it for different reasons, historical reasons, socio-political reasons, there is a certain way in which one could suggest that literary forms do have a popular a presence too, right? Like, so for example, like in the fourth chapter of the book, where I primarily look at the whole debate and the narratives around, lesbian suicides, right? Like, so what, there is one instance where one of the persons who later commits suicide, but one of her friends is remembering her, you know, talking about how she negotiated. And one thing that comes up is that how writing, say, in popular magazines like Manorama about lesbian desire functioned as a way in which she's saying that, you know, if this is there, you know, if this is being written about, then why can't people around us accept it, right? So there is a certain way in which the print becomes a certain, there's a certain circulation, there's a certain way in which the print media also seems to provide certain tropes through which self fashioning or subjectification is being staged, right? Like, and this can move from like, and the other mode that I look at is also the sort of many different lives and afterlives of forms like sentimental fiction or, you know, what is in Malayalam like Pangili writing, right? Where one of the early lesbian novels, Rendu Pengutigal, Two Girls, was actually serialized in a magazine that publishes also Pangili writings, and there is a lot of commonality, you know, in terms of a particular kind of, you know, usage of language, a certain investment in the sensory, in like the pleasures of the body, a certain intense mode of writing about bodily, you know, experiences, you know, like a heightened, you know, what would be then, you could see a certain interlinkage between these forms, right? And in some ways, then the question also comes up as to what memories do they leave, or how do they recur in the present, right? Like, so sometimes they could also be used to delegitimize lesbian women. Because in the reports around lesbian suicide, early reports around lesbian suicide, there is a journalistic account that I look at where the journalist actually says these kind of suicides happen only in rural areas. These are, you know, women who read Pangili literature and they're carried away by their emotions, right? So in that sense, you know, the it's not as if every form of reading has the same kind of the legitimacy too, right? So in some ways then Kerala becomes an interesting space because of also I think the saturation of visual and literary forms and how they acquire a certain you know, how they enter into not just textures of living lives, but also like give you forms of romance, forms of desire that can be sometimes recognized, sometimes marked as excessive, right? Like, so there is in many ways, then I'm also trying to suggest that one cannot actually use only a very, very presentist framework to understand what you say expressions of you know, sexuality, right? Like one would need to think, and that would clearly, like you're saying, that one, we would have to think, I think there is a need to also think across you know, linguistic context too, right? Like, I mean, in that sense, it might be really interesting to think like, what is the difference between Kerala and Tamil Nadu and Karnataka? Because in some senses, if you're looking at activist network, there is a lot of interaction, you know, like say between say the Sangama or Bangalore groups and Kerala, you know, so there is a lot of, you know, clearly a lot of migration, a lot of interaction, right? But in terms of the question of imagination, one would have to see, you know, what, how does it operate differentially and how it might operate similarly also, right? Like, because a certain kind of forms that you are pointing towards, like say the suicide letter, you know, the way, you know, the lots of writing that's emerged around the suicide letters written in Bengali, right? Like the discussion there. And in this particular case that I looked at, which I primarily focused on. There was no suicide note, but there were like all these memories or all the oral narratives that Sahyatrika collected of people remembering, right? And there is even a oral statement that somebody remembers, right? So in some senses, then the oral is getting transcribed, then becoming, entering into a text that that an activist group is putting together, and that is being publicly circulated, right? And in that sense, I also work differently from an ethnographer or an anthropologist, because I didn't go to the, in this particular chapter, at least, I worked primarily with materials that Sahyatrika had already collected. They shared the interviews with me, and then it was also there in the book that Reshma Bharatwaj had published, right? So I worked with already transcribed interviews, but I was also interested in the question that you are raising, right? Like this whole question of why is it that the lesbian suicides in Kerala and the figure of the, that couple, acquires a certain, power or potential. What is the potentiality of this act of suicide, right? Like, what does it pose? How can you read it without folding it into already existing registers of, they are obviously, these are, women who had no access, and therefore, it is predestined to as a narrative of, as an inevitable ending, right? Rather than thinking of it like that, I wanted to look at the narratives themselves and to see what kind of transactions, what idioms are available there. How are these women themselves? What are they drawing on? And often it is not a vocabulary provided by, non-governmental organizations or by a global LGBT discourse, but it is rather much more of a popular print culture that is also entering into the way they are fashioning and performing their romance, right? Like then I think this whole question of how do certain political acts which cannot be easily recuperated, right? Like how does that then leading to your final question about how the national or global scripts of sexuality and recognition and identity gets troubled, and I think the very fact that at least in the early phase of lesbian activism in Kerala, that the suicide became the act that is being memorialized, that you galvanize a public around death, which is what happens, I think, in Rohit Vemula's case also, right? But those, those moments then cannot be easily pulled into the script of, a linear, cohesive subject, right? Like, so I think that way, whether it's a form of the suicide letter, which is a particular kind of, articulation it is almost, in the phase of erasure, you are still speaking, right? Like, so then what does that speech mean, right? And that's why then the whole question of the other form that I actually look at is the ghost story, one of the early short stories of Kamala Das, actually, called Stree, which is about two women and their relation, which takes the form of a ghost story. But in the ways in which the mother of one of the girls who die talks about her, there is a way in which, the whole question of haunting, of spectrality, and that keeps coming up, so in some senses, there are many ways in which there's particular kind of workings of language that, whether it's in activist reports, whether it's in, fictional forms, whether it's in popular magazine writings, all that, I think, is something we would have to engage with very carefully in order to think what is the script of what is the vernacular script of desire or sexuality, you know, and sexuality. Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you for your very clear answer. Sorry for stacking up so many questions together. But there is another, I think you kind of hit upon a very important point, which I think is at the heart of your intervention, which is that there is, I think from what I understand, what you're actually trying to say is that there is no correspondence between visibility and visibility and a positive political valence, right, of that visibility. And I'm just saying that, you know, just by being visible, it doesn't mean that you're actually being you're necessarily being subversive. You know, I mean, I think a lot of it is about how the image is being received. What is the afterlife of the image? Especially, when, let's say, as you said, imagine there's a circulating exhibition. An exhibition, as you say, like Maria's exhibition is not, it's not a complete exhibition. I mean, I think it's a very, like you talked about the lesbian and the sex worker as a processual being, you know, as someone who is in the process of becoming. And exhibition also seems to be something along those lines, you know, where you have different soundscapes, different visual scapes that are intersecting, intercutting over in mutually reinforcing as well as undercutting each other in the exhibition, in the, you know, the kind of the sudden insertion of images of the Pride March or of, you know, so I mean, I think that collage, that kind of collage like quality, which in some sense is not, resists any kind of closure. And I think you also talked about, you know, the pornographic film or the pornographic image. That again, you know, becomes a tricky question, because how does then one negotiate with the gaze? You know, whether it's the male gaze or the patriarchal gaze or a certain, and how does one, you know, how does one negotiate with the work of the camera? You know, what constitutes a positive or an assertive image, and what is an image that reinforces certain stereotypes, whether they are social stereotypes or legal idealizations of gender and sexuality, gendered subjectivity. So I think I don't think there are any easy answers to these questions, you know, because, sometimes, you know, you can have a circulation of a certain image, which in the process of its circulation acquires new dimensions, many of which are unwelcome. There are many times when, you know, it backfires. You know, what you think of as being visible, as being on your face. You know, I mean, we have seen the history of print media in, you know, the history of many of our marginalized movements, where sometimes certain image, whether it's a visual image or a, you know, print image or a moving image, it ends up reinforcing certain stereotypes, and then there has to be this move of reclaiming that very image for yourself. And then say, this is this has been thought of as derogatory. Now we will reclaim it, and then say that this is now, you know, this is what you think it is. So, you know, that's what I was kind of wondering, you know, because I think it's a very slippery boundary. You know, what is politically correct? What is politically positive? What has a positive influence and what doesn't? You know?
I think, you know, like both with sexuality movements and also the women's movement, this has been a question, right? Like, because there is a certain way in which one has presumed that somehow visibility will lead to, a certain kind of political, empowerment or, claiming a certain space, that has been often the strategy of, of all of different forms of progressive politics. But increasingly, I don't think it's a current development, but I think we've become more aware of it now too, right? Like, because within this particular kind of mediated publics, and also when the state itself is so invested in visibility, right? In, you know, with new measures of surveillance, the camera acquiring a certain ubiquity, you know, how do we now recalibrate? What does it mean? What, you know, because that, you know, in some senses, it comes back to this question that no image is then a static one, right? Like, you know, it depends on where, how, what, like, you know, who, how it gets received, where it circulates, you know, and in many ways, I think some of the work that I look at, there is that tension, there is that, you know, there is that, because there's also certain ways in which texts get recouped, right? Like, you know, one of the chapters I look at this Malayalam film, Avalde Ravugal from 1978, which is, you know, like seen as like a pornographic, like soft porn at least, right? Not just in Kerala, but outside too. But over time, you also see different attempts to reclaim the film as a realist text, as, you know, but still there is that impossibility of stabilizing the text. Right, like, so, which I think is, you know, moves away from a certain, you know, the apparatus theory kind of analysis of the gaze and where you are predetermining reception, right? Like that, this you move much more to more of a more what you say, like, you know, there can be like different sensory inhabited ways in which people respond to images, and therefore then in different groups they can take like a certain, you know, even like now with phone cameras, the amount of intimate image making that we are all part of, and, you know, often it's fine that when you share it with a smaller group, you might even want it, you know, like even with Facebook and all, it's very interesting, some of the controversies, right? Like, because, you know, is it a public space? Is it a private space? Can anyone take any image and recirculate it? So it is, I think, but then it brings us back to this, you know, like that heavy investment that we've often had in visibility as a strategy of doing politics, I think is really getting strained at present, right? Like, so there is also then, you know, I think the moment is also asking us to reimagine, like, what are the other modes of doing politics? And the image continues to be, I think, very important in that sense, you know, like that, you know, because it's also because it has that capacity of, you know, acquiring newer meanings, you know, which can go in any direction, like you're saying. There's no, it's not possible actually to contain it and say this is a progressive image and it will remain progressive forever, you know. So it, that I think is an interesting question with visibility and the political, right? Like,
does your book draw linkages between the lesbian and the sex worker? I mean, there must be some reason why you brought those two figures together.
Yeah. I mean, actually, like, the reason I brought the figures together is also there. I think also it comes to the particularity in which the state has created a narrative of gender and sexuality, where in some ways the domestic woman becomes the central icon. Like, you know, the investment within the Kerala, you know, governance discourse of this, you know, well-molded woman who will participate in education, employment, but also be a well-groomed domestic subject. And for the, I mean, in some ways then I was interested in what are the other figures that are there in circulation, feminine figures that they're in circulation, but are constantly, you know, disrupting or impinging upon the domestic. And in many ways, the domestic woman is there all through, I think, because there is no way you can discuss the sex worker or the lesbian in Kerala without thinking about the formations of reproductive heterosexuality, the sort of pressure to belong to within certain structures, right? And that kind of you know, dynamic there, right? And also I, you know, at least when I started the research, which was like early 2000s, it was the moment where, you know, sex workers groups were becoming quite visible, you know, like the, actually I did my MPhil dissertation on this one Malayalam film called Susanna, which was a film, you know, which is taking the Susanna myth, but, you know, reinterpreting it. And it's this film about this one woman who has a relationship with five men. And, you know, it's, and the thing about the film was that the sex workers organization in the state organized a felicitation for the actress and the director. So that was my, you know, interest in the film. Like what happens when the sex worker enters into the public sphere as someone who appreciates, you know, who has something to say about cinema. So it's a different space that you're claiming, right? And then soon after that, you know, and Nalini Jameela was actually part of that. You know, the part of the group that did the felicitation. And at that point, I'd interviewed her. And soon after that, like, you know, a few years after that, she wrote these autobiographies, which got a lot of attention. So it was, in that sense, I think it was a very different moment from now, you know, because there, it almost seemed as if there was a way in which, even Sahyatrika, when you think about Sahyatrika's early interventions, like they also talk about like, how, you know, some of the, you know, spaces were shared, you know, for lesbian women, you know, to gather together. There were very less spaces. And so some of the spaces of sex workers, community spaces were used by, you know, and some of the early articulations, they also talk about many of the women who wrote to them. They were writing about you know, the pressures of domesticity itself, you know, and not necessarily only about, you know, lesbian sexuality, but also about what is the kind of, you know, how is domesticity sort of stifling or, you know, so then in some ways, in yeah, that allowed me to sort of pull these two figures together and to see how they both function as, you know, spaces through which we could rethink some of these, you know, domesticated imaginations of sexuality. And I try to find a longer history for that, you know, from the 50s onwards, at least, like, you know, to think about especially progressive writing, you know, and finally writing, like, you know, two very different modes of writing, but in which, queer desire and sex worker as a figure both, you know, become these interruptions, you know, yeah. So I think that's what sort of interlinks them for me. Yeah.
What I find actually very interesting is that you have this, you're talking about Kamala Das's novel, which was serialized in a fairly mainstream magazine.
I think Matrimony itself, yeah, fairly mainstream magazine, yeah.
What was the public's response to that?
Oh, that I really don't know. The only thing I see, I actually got to know about that story after her death, like, you know, so somebody republished, republished the story, and the editor who was writing the introduction also mentioned that how in her first anthology the story was got. So I think I thought was an interesting thing that it got published, and she published that under the name of Kamala. So that's her first published story, I think. Yeah, so she published when she was very young, but I think it's not one of the stories that's circulated in her lifetime. You know, it's afterwards that it's been retrieved. So that is the only information that I have about, you know, the reception. Again, because Chandana Marangal, which is the other Sandalwood Trees, which is the other novella of hers, which has and even my story, like, has lesbian sex, and those texts have gotten far more attention, even critical attention. But Stree is a very short story, but I found it interesting also because of the form, like, you know, the fact that it is actually using the tropes of a ghost story, like almost like a gothic kind of elements are there, which I thought was interesting, like for a
How accommodating has the women's movement been in Kerala? I mean, in terms of the queer movement, I mean, what are the negotiations that have happened in terms of sex work and, you know, queer women and women's movement?
Yeah, I think that is a long history, and where it is now seems to be a much more, I mean, again, it's very difficult, you know, I think there's always been some forms of solidarity between certain feminist groups and, or at least certain feminists and Sahyatrika and, you know, things like that have been there. And even to some extent, but I think like the sex workers movement, at least initially, like, you know, to like late 1990s, early 2000s, it was a much more tense kind of relationship. I have read earlier statements by more mainstream women's organizations who are not quite sure what to do with this language of, you know, sex work as work and, you know, like, and they are also sometimes saying this is an effect of global tourism, you know, like there is that kind of globalization, a certain, what you say, a commodification of women's bodies, and how can we, even the reception of Nalini Jamila's book is pretty, it's not as if everybody welcomed it in the same way, but say someone like Devika, she translated the book, she's been actively part. So again, you know, like Reshma Bharatwaj has been collaborating with Jamila for a long time. So there have been lots of, you know, interaction in that sense, though, even though some of the mainstream positions were not so, you know, often, I mean, there are like earlier moments also, and in the book I talk about that, like the murder of a sex worker in Calicut in 1980s, where the protest was actually led by the organization that later became Anveshi, you know, which is currently one of the most visible organizations. So there have been alliances, but it's not been an easy one, as you can imagine. But currently, I think there is seems to be much more, you know, much, especially between queer groups and women's groups, there seems to be much more conversations, sharing of space and things like that. Like, you know, I know, yeah. So there has been a lot of shifts over time, in a sense.
Thank you. Now, if the audience has any questions, you may unmute yourself and ask, or you may type your questions in the chat box. So questions, please.
Kiran, there's actually some one of the participants has sent a direct message. You know, he's Manju.
Send your question to the common chat box so that we can all see it. Yeah, you can read it out, Navanita. Yeah, if you.
So it's asked like, how common is the lesbian culture in Kerala, and how is its acceptance in the society? Yeah. That's a, I mean, now the, you know, the whole, it's a complicated question, because in some ways, you know, what do we, when we think about like speech around lesbianism, like discussions around it, say in women's magazines or in print media, or when, you know, individual conversations, clearly there is a possibility of, it, you know, there is a discourse around desire between women. It's not completely absent, but in terms of acceptance, I think still, you know, it's a very, you know, we get into a very difficult terrain, right? Like, because, you know, there are still, like, as I was also mentioning, you know, there are still reports, you know, continuing reports about kind of, you know, ways in which, especially within families, like the, you know, the discrimination people face, or and often also, you know, there are women who are living together in Kerala, and there are organizations who are, you know, often supporting some of these women. So it's not as if it's not there, but to ask whether there's a large scale acceptance, that is, I think it's still a very, you know, it's a very, you know, women still have to struggle, right? Like, in order to live the lives they want to live, because the pressure often, like, you know, even when I was just reading that report around the number 16, the suicide, again, two young women, you know, who committed suicide together, and it's again very familiar script, right? They were very close friends, going to college together, and then there is the pressure on one girl's marriage gets fixed, and then they, so this whole idea that marriage is the logical, institution that you should enter into, and, you know, the anxiety produced by women who opt not to enter into that, I think is a continuing larger issue, right? And also, like, you know, with Anjana's suicide, there was again a lot of conversation around how psychiatric institutions are being called upon to even do conversion therapy, and so in that sense, there is, one would have to talk about these kind of, so the legal is only it's just often, the spirit, one would have to think of the how the social interacts with the legal, or, and what is the life of the law in that sense, right? Like, how is it, what happens to it in practice, So in some senses, maybe there is a change in the way, it looks like some cases, at least the way the courts respond or the police respond, could, one would have to do, I think, more ethnographic work also to see how, whether state institutions are, engaging differently with women now. But yeah, that, there's a lot to be done, I think.
Other questions from the audience? You know, I was also thinking of when you're talking about Kamala Das, and I was just thinking also the sandalwood trees, as well as about how even the male characters in the stories seem rather effete or effeminate. Mm-hmm. And in my story, I think it seems like the husband is also having his own share of affairs, and it almost becomes a marriage of convenience. Sometimes seems to have the space to explore her own relationship, which her husband, I don't know, I think her husband wasn't surprised. There wasn't a typical reaction of suspicion, jealousy, or anything. And even in the sandalwood trees, I think I remember in that story that there was I think one of the women was married to an older man who wasn't attractive.
Yeah.
The other woman's friend was a very wild character. Like, she was very rebellious and wild and almost rather tomboyish initially, and then she marries someone. I think she leaves her husband and she marries another man, and then she's in Australia, if I'm not mistaken.
She's sitting back. She's
hopes of getting back with this woman, but then, I mean, I think the contrast, I think, was important. I think for the time and when it was published, the contrast between who was domestic and who was unwilling to let go of everything, despite the fact that her husband doesn't give her any pleasure or satisfaction. And a woman who couldn't care less. And I'm the story ends. I don't remember how it ended, but it was an interesting contrast, I remember, of those two characters.
I think the woman stays on in her marriage. No, the other is, I don't think, is my, but coming, there are certain other short stories also that I've gotten interested, which I've been trying to also translate more recently, which is by this writer who also directed Desharna Kili Kariyarla, like, you know, Padmarajan, right? So he's written a lot of short stories. And the interesting thing about many of those short stories is also it's often a kind of a triangulation. So there is often like for example, there's one story in which it's like a you know, it's basically a young boy's point of view, and it's a sister who's meeting her lover, you know, an other man. And basically they're going to break up. It's a breakup moment. But before breakup, they want to have sex, like the last, she's going to get married. So they take this young boy along, like sort of a chaperone, and put him in one room, and then they're going into the other room. And they're thinking he's too young, he doesn't know what's happening. But he knows everything in the story. And the thing is that his main problem is that he's really jealous of his sister, because he's very attracted to the man, to the other man. So it's from, you know, the sister's lover. And so he's like really, you know, so it's a very short story, but it's very interesting how it creates this kind of drama of desire, you know, where there's all kinds of directions happening. And, you know, in that sense, one of the early novels in Malayalam, which got a lot of, which got banned and really attacked, like, you know, Bashir's Shabdangal, which is sounds, you know, that again is a very interesting text, because it's very difficult to even categorize what is the form of, how do you play it? If you cannot really place it within any, you know, neat category, because it's a man who's attracted to another person who he thinks is a woman, but then at the moment of the sexual encounter, he realizes it's a man, right? And then he still goes ahead and has sex, but, you know, so there is, you know, it's difficult to even, and the many kind of responses, even in the scene of sex, there is both desire, but there is some kind of repulsion. So it's an, you know, in some senses, then it really, presents the scene of sexuality as a much more, fractured one, right? Rather than leading to any, you know, a clear formation of knowledge or self-recognition, right? Like, so, yeah, so that, I think even in, even in Kamaladas, you could think of those. No, she's very interested in those kind of, a kind of slippery ways in which these subjects are negotiating a field, right? Like sexuality more as a field rather than a certain linear, story of recognition, right? Yeah.
Now that you say this, I'm reminded of that moment in the Sandalwood Trees where the husband discovers that the other woman desires his wife. The moment where he emasculated. Can I competing with another woman? If it were another man, it would be a little bit more consoling. But if it was another woman who also is a little masculine, that he feels inadequate.
Yeah.
But that was very interesting. I think a couple of questions in the chat box. One, I think, is this is from Shalu Yadav. I want to ask whether all other concepts related to men are accepted in society. Will the concept of being gay, I guess, get acceptance sooner than being lesbian?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, again, you know, I don't want to give a overarching answer like that. You would have to look at within a different context, like, you know, what gets acceptance, but it might be, you know, in terms of just more material questions about mobility, access to spaces, you know, often there is a recognition that men are sexual beings, you know, with women that itself, you know, is something you have to establish, right? Like, you know, even, you know, forget which direction, but there is the general, you know, that the kind of idea about femininity as much more as something that's much more contained, controlled, should be channelized in right directions, that kind of burden does not accrue in the same way on at least certain privileged masculine subjects, right? Because there is a recognition that men are sexual beings, they need outlets, they have a claim to mobility, so access to certain privileges, right? Like, so one would have to think about it in those terms, right? And therefore then what happens to what are the repercussions on what is seen as a non-normative desire on different, on masculine and feminine subjects is often very different, right? Because even when you think about the pattern of lesbian suicides in Kerala, it is often lesbian women that there are few cases of, at least in the context of Kerala, but it is not, we do have a lot of reports also of young gay men who have, died too, right? Like, so one would have to really, break it down and think about it, right? But I think it comes down to this question as to how the construction of masculinity and femininity in terms of sexuality itself is often very different, like in the Indian context. Yeah. So,
on your views on the representation of queerness, gayness in Mumbai police.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. It's not a film that I have seen the film, but it's not a film that I have, really thought about in great detail. Like, it was, I guess, an interesting film because also, showing in terms of star presence, like the fact that you have a well-known actor playing the role of the of a gay man, but then how does it deal with gayness? Like that it's a film that I actually find very difficult to take a position on or anything. So if I had to talk about it, I would really have to spend more time on it and look at it much more carefully, I think. Yeah.
I just have one question, Navanita, which is, does your book also touch on the intersections of queer femininity and transgenderedness? I mean, on, especially the woman who might be a cis woman, might be cross-dressing or might sport certain, perform a certain masculinity, who might be protected in some ways because she is, I mean, if she successfully passes off as if she is a cis woman and passes off as a man, gets a certain degree of protection or let's say a certain degree of anonymity because she's not visible as a woman, cis woman. And she then, and she can also then, therefore, for the same reason, also be the object of a lot of violence and shame. So that she's put into place. So do you see, do you see instances of that in any of the forms that you have studied? Do you see instances of the lesbian or the queer woman who is either a cis woman who is masculine, maybe butch, if you like that term, a woman or a trans man is again, maybe identifies as queer, also the object of violence or anonymity.
No, the film that I was talking about, like which I opened with, Iratta Jeevitham, I think that way is interesting, but that's not a film I discuss in the book because it's a much more recent film. But it's interesting in terms of how it's trying to produce this narrative around this trans man who is returning home, and the home space is after transitioning, right? And also it's a, it's a fishing community. And then the question becomes also about about employment, about trying to survive, you know, in this economy, who will give him a job, and the many kind of, you know, on the one hand, there's the certain, there's the desire he feels for Saina, who was his older friend, and he's negotiating that. But there is also a way in which he himself attracts a lot of attention, like, you know, where it, so there's a lot of shots in the film of Adraman moving around in the village, and you see people looking at him, and, you know, also sexually, you know, either, you know, even towards the end of the film, there is actually even an attempted sexual assault, right? You know, so there is a certain, I mean, and actually one of the characters who, but then it's also trying to stitch him in within that community space. So there is his mother who's trying to come to terms with his, you know, return. There's a sex worker in the village who's actually quite sympathetic. So it is in that sense an interesting text, I think, to think more about also, you know, much more about in the last 10 years, there's a lot more films especially, but also larger discourse around trans politics in the Kerala context, like especially after the Nalsa judgment, the new policies that the state has made. So one would have to, you know, I think like the most of my, what I looked at in the book, you know, that phase of sexuality politics has also shifted, I think, in the last 5-6 years. And some of the questions you are asking acquires greater salience right now, right? Like, so one would have to, you know, look at newly emerging groups and, you know, like, I mean, there was this whole discussion around like a trans model being featured on as the cover of Vanita, you know, so there is in the, you know, there's a lot of research also happening. Many, you know, researchers now looking at both cinematic productions, but also the larger kind of cultural, political discourse around trans. You know, there's also even like some ways in which people are even returning to some of these earlier what was being called lesbian suicides, and also thinking about how many of those women who were then, you know, categorized as women were also often making claims on masculinity, even in the, you know, particular report that I look at, one of the women actually, and that becomes a way in which she also tries to negotiate, because she's the one who does all the work, she's economically productive, and her mother keeps saying that she was also, you know, she was my support in all kinds of ways, she was the one who was, you know, the caretaker of the household, and, you know, and in some senses she is the one who's more vocal, the one who feels that they have a chance, you know, at least till a certain point of time, right? So it is interesting how that then her gendered negotiations allows her to also you know, navigate the field of sexuality differently.
Thank you very much. Any other further questions from the participants?
We have time for a question or so. Any further questions? All right. If there are no further questions, then thank you very much, Navanita. Thank you for spending time with us and for that wonderful presentation. Thank you very much. I hope all of you enjoyed it. I certainly learned a lot. And thank you very much. And I hope to see you again in the first week of December for our next session on gender and sexuality, presented by Anna Jury and team. Thank you very much, Navanita. Thank you. Thank you all for being here.
Thanks.